like
Bhagavan,
Bhagavan,
Lord Shiva,
Lord Shiva,
Prabhum Harlong. Translation from Portuguese language. A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation. Maitreya continued. After the departure of her parents, the chaste woman Devahuti, who could understand the desires of her husband, served him constantly with great love, as Bhavani, the wife of Lord Shiva, serves her husband. Can you repeat the translation? Maitreya continued. After the departure, of her parents, the chaste woman Devahuti, who could understand the desires of her husband, served him constantly with great love, as Bhavani, the wife of Lord Shiva, serves her husband. The specific example of Bhavani is very significant. Bhavani means the wife of Bhava or Lord Shiva. Bhavani or Parvati, the daughter of the king of the Himalayas, selected Lord Shiva, who appears to be just like a beggar, as her husband. In spite of her being a princess, she undertook all kinds of tribulation to associate with Lord Shiva, who did not even have a house, but was sitting underneath the tree and passing his time in meditation. Although Bhavani was the daughter of a very great king, she used to serve Lord Shiva just like a poor woman. Similarly, Devahuti was the daughter of an emperor, Swayambhuva Manu, yet she preferred to accept Kartama Muni as her husband. She served him with great love and affection, and she knew how to please him. Therefore, she is designated here as Sadhavi, which means a chaste, faithful wife. Her rare example is the ideal of Vedic civilization. Every woman is expected to be as good and chaste as Devahuti or Bhavani. Today in Hindu society, unmarried girls are still taught to worship Lord Shiva with the idea that they may get husbands like him. Lord Shiva is the ideal husband, not in the sense of riches or sense gratification, but because he is the greatest of all devotees. Vaishnava Yatha Shambhu. Shambhu or Lord Shiva is the ideal Vaishnava. He constantly meditates upon Lord Rama and chants Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Lord Shiva has a Vaishnava Sampradaya, which is called the Vishnu Swami Sampradaya. Unmarried girls worship Lord Shiva so that they can expect a husband who is as good a Vaishnava as he. The girls are not taught to select a husband who is very rich or very opulent for material sense gratification. Rather, if a girl is fortunate enough to get a husband as good as Lord Shiva in devotional service, then her life becomes perfect. The wife is dependent on the husband, and if the husband is a Vaishnava, then naturally she shares the devotional service of the husband because she renders him service. This reciprocation of service and love between husband and wife is the ideal of a householder's life. The same is the Bhaktivedanta purport. Om Ajnana Kirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Nibitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. नमो ओम विष्णु पादाय
प्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामिन इति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
सो इन द प्रीवियस वर्सेस वी सॉ
that Swayambhu Manu, after leaving the daughter, he goes back to his kingdom. And then we saw the description of the kingdom of Swayambhuva Manu, how he and his subject with his family, everyone were completely absorbed in the thoughts of the Lord, in discussing, in hearing Krishna Katha. Now here is the description of daughter of Swayambhuva Manu. Her special characteristic, very nicely this chapter will describe how faithfully she served Kardama Muni. And as a result, she was benedicted with a son who was none other but Lord himself, Kapila. And then Kapila Muni would enlighten Devahuti. So here we can see that after the departure of her father, she very faithfully served Kardama Muni, exactly like Bhavani, Parvati, Mother Parvati would serve Lord Shiva. So Prabhupada is very offering some very enlightening aspects of Lord Shiva and Parvati and how Parvati served Lord Shiva. So Prabhupada explains that here Bhavani refers to wife of Lord Shiva, who is also called Bhava, who is in charge of this material world. And she is in charge of maintaining Shrishti, Stiti, Pralaya, Sadhana, Shakti, Rekha, Durga or Parvati is the same, wife of Lord Shiva. So Prabhupada says, who was Parvati actually? She was the princess of King of Himalayas. So actually, materially, she was most opulent. Moreover, actually speaking, she is the in charge of this whole material world, Durga. Everything is conducted by material nature in this world. Of course, we understand that it is all done under the supervision of the Lord. Maya adhyakshena prakriti suyate sa charachara. But as far as Durga is concerned, she is the one who conducts the affair of this material world. So much so, Prabhupada explains, that she has a power of creating the whole world, the whole universe. Shrishti, Stiti, Pralaya, Sadhana, Shakti, Rekha. She has so much power. So, this is her position. Also, she was princess, daughter of the King of Himalayas. But whom did she accept as her husband? Not some great prince or great king of some big kingdom. She accepted somebody who was like a beggar, Lord Shiva. She accepted somebody who had no house, no residence to live in. Generally, when a woman is married, the parents, first of all, they see whether they have some land, whether they have some house, whether they have some money. All these are very important considerations which people consider. But here we find Parvati never considered all those things, whether he has a house so that I am now princess, whether I will be able to live comfortably or not. Imagine, she knows very well, after getting married, I have to live under a tree. Because Lord Shiva has no residence, isn't it? Sometimes he lives in crematorium, sometimes under a tree. But in spite of that, she selected him to be husband. Then Prabhupada explains after coming to the house of Lord Shiva, after getting married, she never maintained her original material status. According to the position of the husband, she also became poverty-stricken. And she served the husband like a poor woman. He is in a poverty condition, and similarly, she also takes that poverty condition and serves. So Prabhupada is comparing that actually, similar is the situation of Devahuti and Kardama Muni. Devahuti is a princess. She is coming from the house of a great emperor like Swayambhuva Manu. In all opulence, in all comfort, we saw the description of the kingdom, right? But just like Parvati did not consider about the material position of Lord Shiva, similarly, Devahuti did not consider about this material position of Kardama Muni, that he is living in a hermit. He is living in a simple hut. And that he is a simple Brahmana. He is not materially opulent. He is not having some big kingdom. She also did not consider this. And similarly to Parvati, she also took that position like a menial servant and served Kardama Muni, understanding his desires and trying to satisfy all those desires. Of course, Kardama Muni did not have material desires, and she was not trying to satisfy the material desires of Kardama Muni. That has to be understood. He is a great devotee of the Lord. Just like Lord Shiva is a great devotee of the Lord. So Prabhupada, that's why he is saying, if somebody has to become an ideal wife, then they should take example from Devahuti and Mother Parvati. Both of them, according to Vedic civilization, are very ideal and chaste wife. That's how Prabhupada gives an example that in the Vedic culture, the woman, the girl, they were advised to worship Lord Shiva. Why they would worship Lord Shiva? Because they would worship Lord Shiva, asking him that please benedict me that when I get married, I get a husband like you. So that means, Prabhupada explains, the girls were trained that when they get married, they should not be looking for some material comforts of life. Rather, they should be looking for devotional qualities like Lord Shiva. So Prabhupada is explaining here, what is Lord Shiva? Vaishnava Naam Yatha Shambhu. It's a great devotee of the Lord. Isn't it? So Prabhupada is giving the example. What is the meaning of Lord Shiva? Because he is the greatest of the Vaishnavas. Vaishnava Naam Yatha Shambhu. He constantly meditates on Lord Rama. He's always chanting. He's always absorbed. Isn't it? Sometimes people wonder, when, you know, this is one of the arguments we can give. People wonder that whether Lord Shiva is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But actually, we find that Lord Shiva is always in meditation. On whom is he meditating? He is always meditating on his worshipable deity, Lord Rama. So Prabhupada is saying, he's always chanting, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. Correct? So that is another thing. Then, another great importance about Lord Shiva is that he is one of the Mahajanas. Not only the Mahajana, he heads one of the Vaishnava Sampradaya. He is the head of Sampradaya, which is called as Vishnu Swami Sampradaya. So, Prabhupada is saying that just like Parvati served Lord Shiva and she was able to share all the devotional qualities of Lord Shiva, similarly, any chaste wife who serves her husband, who is a great devotee of the Lord, actually gets benedicted with all benedictions of devotional qualities. So in that sense, the wife serves the husband, because if the husband is a great devotee of the Lord and she is serving a great devotee of the Lord, actually it is higher than serving the Lord. That was the doubt of Mother Parvati, because Mother Parvati, very chastely, she was serving Lord Shiva. And she asked this question to Lord Shiva, which is the greatest worship? So Lord Shiva replied, yes, the greatest worship is worshipping Lord Vishnu. So then she was little, you know, dissatisfied. She was thinking that actually I am not in that sense directly worshipping Lord Vishnu. But then Shiva further said, greater than the worship of Lord Vishnu is worshipping anything, devotees or paraphernalia, which are in connection with Lord Vishnu. Tadiyanam samarchanam. Tadiyanam means in connection with the Lord, devotees of the Lord. So we can see this. This is actually very interesting insight Prabhupada offers in our Vedic civilization. So with respect to Parvati and Lord Shiva, Prabhupada describes something very interesting. Prabhupada describes that actually Lord Shiva, he is not very much bothered about material prosperity, material opulence. Daksha was very concerned when he wanted to hand over his daughter. He was very concerned that whom am I handing over? But Lord Shiva is actually unconcerned about so-called material condition, material prosperity, for which everybody is very eager. And then Prabhupada says, actually, Parvati is nothing but Mother Durga. She is the wife of Lord Shiva, fully under her control, very obedient. But even though she can make a whole universe, Lord Shiva never utilizes her to make a residence for himself. See, this is very wonderful. He has all the opportunity, never misuses the opportunity for his sense gratification. She is wife. She is the controller of this material nature. She has a potency of creating big, big universes. But Lord Shiva never uses her for his sense gratification. So, then Prabhupada explains, generally people worship Mother Durga for material prosperity. You see? But Shiva engages her in the service of the Lord. People engage Mother Durga in their sense gratification when they worship her. But Lord Shiva is so great, he never uses her for his sense gratification. He uses her in the service of the Lord. How? Prabhupada is saying, he simply advises his great wife that of all kinds of worship, the worship of Vishnu is the highest. And greater than the worship of a great is a worship of a great devotee or anything in relation with Lord Vishnu. Then Prabhupada explains about, he cites one story about Lord Shiva, that what happened, that Lord Shiva and Parvati were discussing that people are criticizing us, what kind of husband and wife they have. They don't even have a residence. They're just living under a tree. What kind of example they are setting? So, at least for this sake, so that we will not be criticized like this, let us have a residence. So they planned, and Lord Shiva is all powerful, so he made a very beautiful golden house. And in that golden house, for house opening ceremony, he invited Brahmanas, especially headed by Garga Muni. So all these Brahmanas came, and then nice feast was prepared and everybody was served. And they ate so much, because actually they were testing Lord Shiva. They ate so much that practically everything was empty. And then finally the time came when they were going back home, they asked for Dakshina. So Lord Shiva has had, now practically everything is over, he had nothing to give as Dakshina. So then both husband and wife discussed, what should we give? Then they said, let us give away this house itself. So then as Dakshina of the housewarming ceremony, they gave away the house. So Prabhupada is saying, the result of making a house and a housewarming ceremony is, again they became houseless. Again they became under a tree. You see. So actually this is a great opulence of Lord Shiva. He's completely renounced from all kind of material prosperity, material opulences. And this is the opulence of Mother Parvati, that actually she is benedicted to serve the greatest of the Vaishnavas. And actually that is the most important lesson which we can learn from what Mother Parvati's selection was. What were the criterions, what were the conditions that she looked for? So that is what Prabhupada is stating in today's purport very nicely. It's very interesting. Prabhupada is saying, today in Hindu society, unmarried girls are still taught to worship Lord Shiva with the idea they may get husband like him. Not that they are worshipping Lord Shiva, thinking they will get a husband who will be having all kinds of material facility and prosperity. No, this was not the idea. The idea was that they will get husband like Lord Shiva, who is a great devotee of the Lord. Lord Shiva is the ideal husband, not in the sense of riches or sense gratification, but because he is the greatest of the devotees, Vaishnavanam Yathasham. The girls are not taught to select a husband who is very rich or very opulent for material sense gratification. Rather, if the girl is fortunate enough to get a husband as good as Lord Shiva in devotional service, then her life becomes perfect. See, this is the whole thing. Husband is a great devotee of the Lord, and what does our Vaishnava philosophy say? We have to serve great devotees of the Lord. The secret of success is not serving Krishna directly. The secret of success is in serving pure devotee of the Lord. So imagine what is a great fortune of a woman who gets the husband as a pure devotee like Lord Shiva or Kardama Muni. So is there any doubt that by serving such a pure devotee of the Lord, by serving such a great devotee of the Lord, they will not advance? So automatically they share all the results of the husband, if the husband is a great devotee of the Lord. So these are the ideal characteristic. Husband should be a great devotee, and wife should serve such a great devotee very chastely. Just like here, we find the example of both Devahuti and Mother Parvati. There is another very interesting story which we heard about, I think, few days back in Prabhupada's class, about another chaste woman, Savitri, Satyavan and Savitri. So there, Prabhupada offers a very interesting lesson from the life incidents of Satyavan and Savitri. What happened was that Savitri was in love with a boy by name Satyavan, but there was a prediction that on the day of their marriage, after their marriage, he would die. But in spite of her chastity, so she still agreed, that does not matter, I will marry. And then she satisfied Yamaraj, and then automatically when a great devotee is satisfied, then they give benedictions. So Yamaraj was benedicting, what do you want? So then Savitri said, I want a good son. So he said, okay, very good, you will have. So then she said, so then Yamaraj was taking away Satyavan. Then she said, where are you taking? Why are you taking him? He said, no, his time has come. He's supposed to die. So after that, I have to carry him. So he said, but you have given me benediction that I am going to have a son. How I am going to have a son without husband? Right? So then automatically, the husband had to be made alive. So Prabhupada quotes this. He says, just like Savitri, she just actually asked for a benediction of a son. By that benediction, automatically the husband was made alive. Similarly, Prabhupada says, if we just understand this point, that somehow or other, if we can make our worshipable deity as Krishna, Krishna Devata, then automatically all other benedictions like eternality, then we automatically become eternal. All other benedictions will automatically come. Just like with one benediction, you get a son, automatically husband is made alive. So this is a interesting example Prabhupada gives from the life of Satyavati and Satyavan, Savitri and Satyavan. There is another very interesting story we have been hearing in Chaitanya Charitamrita from few days. What happened? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, before he went to the South Indian trip, so he was visiting all the different places near Jagannath Puri. So he went to Katak, from there he went to Sakshi Gopal temple. So there, Lord Nityananda, who had earlier visited Katak and who had earlier visited Sakshi Gopal temple, from the local people there, he had heard about the story of Sakshi Gopal. So very, very attentively he heard that story, and now he was narrating this story to Lord Chaitanya. And Lord Chaitanya was also very, very anxiously, very, very attentively he was hearing this story. So actually, what is this story? This story is about marriage of one younger Brahmana to the daughter of one elderly Brahmana. So one may wonder, what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has got to do with hearing whole story of how this daughter got married to that younger Brahmana finally? Why Lord Nityananda took so much interest in hearing that story, and not only hearing, now he is reciting to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that story? Isn't it? So Prabhupada very nicely comments on that. It is very interesting. So, Nityananda Prabhu is reciting this story when this Bada Brahmana, elderly Brahmana, is offering because he has served him. So what happened was, actually there were these two Brahmanas from Vidyanagar in South India. they were going on a tour of pilgrimage. They went to Prayag, they went to Kashi, all these sacred places they went. Finally, they went to Vrindavan, Mathura, Vrindavan, all these places. They went to all the different forests, and finally they came to the temple, which was, at that time it was called as Sri Gopal Temple. Today it is, Prabhupada says, today it is called as Govinda Temple there, because Gopal deities have moved out from there. You know, they went to this place, Ramuna, Sakshi Gopal. So, when this Brahmana, the elderly Brahmana, was very old, he was little invalid, not able to travel properly. So, this younger Brahmana served him very nicely, because actually, this is called Vaishnava Seva. And what was he serving him? He was not serving him in sense gratification. He was taking him to all pilgrimage places, places of the remembrance of the Lord. So in that he was assisting this elderly Brahmana. So this elderly Brahmana was very pleased with his service. He was very satisfied. And he said, I want to benedict you. I want to marry my daughter with you. So, seeing the material position of both of them, the younger Brahmana, he refused first. He said, what are you saying? Your position is different, my position is different. I am a poverty-stricken Brahmana. You are well-placed. Please consider. Haven't you heard the story of Rukmini? That father earlier agreed, but brother and relatives did not agree. Finally, father had to change his mind. And then he wanted to marry his daughter to Shishupala. Similar thing is going to happen. You may agree, your relatives, your family people, your sons, they will agree. But still he said, no, don't worry about this. I am giving my words in front of the deities here. I am going to keep my words. So in that context, Prabhupada is nicely in the purport explains something very interesting. So this younger Brahmana is saying, sir, I am not a suitable bridegroom for your daughter. I render service to you only for the satisfaction of Krishna. I have not rendered service that wanted some benediction from you. I have rendered service because that is for the satisfaction of the Lord. Serving a devotee is the satisfaction of the Lord. I have not served you for some sense enjoyment, some sense gratification. I wanted some reward. No, that is not my motto. Then he is further saying, Lord Krishna is very much pleased by service rendered to Brahmanas. And when the Lord is pleased, the opulence of one's devotional service increases. So he's saying, I have served you so that I can also advance in devotional service, because by pleasing Brahmanas, by pleasing Vaishnavas, the Lord becomes pleased. So in this context, Prabhupada in the purport explains something very wonderful. Prabhupada says in the purport, in this regard, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur comments that the younger Brahmana rendered service to the older Brahmana with the purpose of pleasing Krishna. It was not a matter of ordinary worldly dealing. This is very important. This interactions between these two devotees is the only purpose of their interaction was to please Krishna. See, this is very important. Otherwise, one may wonder why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is interested in hearing about their stories. These dealings of these two Brahmanas, this dealing of these two Vaishnavas is not ordinary dealing. This is the dealing of the Vaishnavas. Because their only purpose was to please Krishna. So, then further Prabhupada is saying, it was not a matter of ordinary worldly dealing. Krishna is pleased when a Vaishnava is rendered service. Because the younger Brahmana served the older one, Lord Gopala agreed to become a witness of the marriage negotiation in order to maintain the prestige of both devotees. See, this is also very important. It is not that simply the Lord became a witness. Lord does not become witness for everybody. Of course, He is a witness in the heart for everything, no doubt. But here, even in the form of a deity, He agreed to become a witness. That yes, when the time come, I will be witness, don't worry. So, it is not for ordinary thing. Because these were the dealings of the devotees, the Lord also agreed because of that purpose only. Not for some other purpose. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would certainly not have liked to hear about marital dealings unless such dealings were exchanged between two Vaishnavas. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would close his ears hearing about woman and man, dealings of woman and man. He would never hear about such dealings. Right? We have heard that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was so strict that even if a woman had to offer obeisances, they had to be far away. Such a great sannyasi who was following strictly is now hearing about marital relationship of Vaishnavas. See? So Prabhupada is saying because they were not ordinary dealings. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would certainly not have liked to hear about marital dealings unless such dealings were exchanged between two Vaishnavas. Marriage arrangements and ceremonies belong to ordinary material karma kanda section of the scriptures. Actually, general marriages are performed according to karma kanda section. Vaishnavas, however, are not interested in any kind of karma kanda. But actually, Vaishnavas are not interested in karma kanda. Narottam Das Thakur says, karma kanda, jnana kanda, kevala, vishera bhanda. For a Vaishnava, karma kanda, jnana kanda section of the Vedas are unnecessary, like a poison pot. Then Prabhupada is giving his own example. Sometimes we take part in a marriage ceremony for our disciples. As a sannyasi, actually Prabhupada performed many marriages of his disciples. Sannyasi is actually not supposed to perform marriages. But this does not mean we are interested in karma kanda activities. Sometimes, not knowing the Vaishnava philosophy, an outsider criticizes such activity, maintaining a sannyasi should not take part in marriage ceremony between a young boy and a young girl. However, this is not a karma kanda activity because our purpose is to spread Krishna consciousness movement. We are giving all facility to the general populace to take to Krishna consciousness. And for that, what is required? Then Prabhupada is saying. And in order to fix the devotees in concentration on the service of the Lord, marriage is sometimes allowed. We have experienced that such married couple actually render very important service to the mission. Therefore, one should not misunderstand when a sannyasi takes part in marriage ceremony. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Nityananda Prabhu took great pleasure in hearing about the marriage ceremony between the young Brahmana and the daughter of the elderly Brahmana. Not for some other purpose, but because it was the dealing of the Vaishnavas. So, actually this is what we can see here. What we can learn from this is, as Prabhupada is saying, that Devahuti, understanding Kardama Muni to be a great devotee of the Lord, a great personality, a great saintly man, she came down to the position of that same kind of austerity and poverty condition, and understanding all the desires of Kardama Muni, tried to serve just like Bhavani, Mother Parvati, served Lord Shiva. And in such a kind of a dealing, there is no doubt definitely that both of them will advance. And that's what Prabhupada is saying. This reciprocation of service and love between husband and wife is the ideal of a householder's life. So we'll stop with this. Grantharashimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.